Joining me now with his perspective on the case to date, President and CEO of West Coast Trial Lawyers, Neama Rahmani. Now, Neama, we're all watching the hearings as best as we can, the testimony that's coming forward, the witnesses coming forward, but a lot of this is also perception. People, in a lot of ways, at least public perception, you see people protesting outside all around the country. How much do you really see perception impacting this case?
Natalie, perception has a huge impact on this case. There's going to be significant pressure on these jurors to return guilty verdicts. Whether it's second-degree murder, that top count, or third degree, an acquittal here, full acquittal, is going to result in significant civil unrest. So I can see these jurors at least returning a manslaughter verdict, probably third degree as well.
You're right. We all saw the riots last summer and the burning down the businesses that happened in Minneapolis. And those people were really hurting at that time. And a lot of them were on the same side where they were even putting up signs like, don't burn down. I agree with you. But there was so much unrest. And even as we heard of some of the juror selection, people were afraid of serving on this jury simply because if their name was leaked, whether their family was going to come under assault. So there's almost that fear factor in this trial where the public has already made up their minds for the most part of what happened in this case, but they're still trying to hear both sides of the story because in America, it still is, even when we don't like it or not, innocent until proven guilty. And that's what these jurors are having to do. So in the minds of these jurors, as they're hearing the testimony, of course, the witnesses being cross-examined and getting to hear, you know, whether or not they're credible witnesses to the story. As you see that in the minds of these witnesses, how do you think the case is going so far on both sides? Again, legally speaking, leaving the public perception out of this.
Well, this case is going well for the prosecution. We know how incredibly difficult it is to convict law enforcement in this country. They're rarely charged, much less charged with murder, and almost never convicted of murder. But this is a unique case where Derek Chauvin didn't have to make a split-second decision whether to pull the trigger. That 9 minutes and 29 seconds, the prosecution has done an outstanding job dissecting every minute of Chauvin's knee on Floyd's neck. And not only that, they've done a good job of co-opting the defense's argument that this is law enforcement versus civilians. Their witnesses so far, Jenna Scurry, Genevieve Hansen, these are all law enforcement types. And they're actually going to call Chief Arendano of the Minneapolis Police Department, who is also going to testify that Chauvin's use of force was excessive.
You're right. We all saw the video in 9 minutes. As you said, there was a lot of time to change your mind on what was going on. But you hear that on the other side of it, of course, they're trying to act like it's police protocol. But you also hear reports of the drugs in his system. Now, obviously, we all saw how he was treated, which is completely unacceptable. But some people are trying to make the case that he died from a drug overdose or he would have died anyway. So somehow that lessens the blame on the officer, even though we all saw the video. Do you think that has any credibility in here in terms of witnesses hearing, oh, well, he might have died anyway? Once you have that footage, the 9 minutes we found out again. Again, it was more than 9 minutes. Everybody thought it was the 7 minutes and, you know, the certain amount of seconds. And now we find out it was actually 9 minutes.
Yeah, we started at 7:46 and 8:46. That was the number. And now we're at 9:29. It turns out that we didn't have the full video. But the defense is going for a home run here on causation, right? They're talking about the fentanyl. They're talking about methamphetamine. They're talking about Floyd's underlying health condition. So it's absolutely possible that they get one, two, or even more jurors to buy that causation argument. They're going to have their medical experts. The prosecution is going to have theirs. So no question, that is the best defense argument. After that, they're going to intent. That top count requires the intent to commit assault, right? That's that felony murder. That second, the third degree murder, which is the second count, requires that depraved mind. And lastly is that manslaughter count that requires culpable negligence. So the defense is going to try to parse away and work down that intent and argue to their jurors, this is a law enforcement officer. He's been doing this for 19 years. This is his training, and he did not intend to commit assault or have that depraved mind to kill George Floyd.
So based on, I know it's hard to ask you to summarize a judgment right now before the case is actually wrapped up, but do you think that there will definitely be a verdict, but some of the extra charges that were added on at the last minute, first they were taken away, then they were added on, do you think that's probably what's going to happen where it's going to be partial? Some are not guilty, some are guilty, but he will have to pay for at least one of the charges against him.
I think the manslaughter is a gimme at this point. I mean, that's close to that $27 million civil verdict. That was essentially what he was going to plead to, but the Attorney General, Bill Barr, said no, he rejected that deal. Second degree is going to be tough because, again, it requires that intent to commit assault. I think the prosecution will get there, but the jury may fall back on that third degree, and that's why it is so important for the prosecution to get that charge back in. It's still up on appeal to the Minnesota Supreme Court. The only officer to ever be convicted of third-degree murder is Muhammad Noor, and his case is still pending. So it'll be interesting to see if the jury pivots to that third-degree count and what happens to the Noor appeal.
Well, thank you for tracking this story, Neama, because there's so much to unravel between perception and what actually happened. And getting to hear your opinion on the subject based on the facts as a lawyer is really appreciated. And we're going to have you back on as this case develops and we eventually reach a verdict. So thank you for that.
Thanks for having me, Natalie.